Hey everybody, and welcome back to Moda with Ellery, and in this episode we're going to be looking at how to use an ambient occlusion pass to give you a better quality render, a cleaner render, and a render that has more detail. So a lot of this we're going to be moving over to Photoshop to work on, but we're going to start here actually looking at Modo and some things that we can set up in order to adjust render quality and settings in order to get something good. But then at the same time we want to look and see where there's that tipping point of it's just taking too long to render and the quality is not significantly better than what we could get quickly, especially if we implement an ambient occlusion pass to help us add in some of the details and some of the extra stuff that might get lost when you're using a radiance caching, depending on your settings. All right, so we've got this pretty simple scene here, and in this scene, this is just a bunch of replicators, essentially, and it's replicators on a very simple environment, and so we've got replicated panels. This is actually part of something that's going to be coming up pretty soon. I'll have an announcement with the launch of Pixel Fondue very shortly. Pixelfondue.com. Make sure you go check that out if you have not yet, and you can also do a YouTube search for Pixel Fondue, so a little bit of a plug there. All right, so we've got this scene here, and if you look at this, this is just the stock default out-of-the-box settings for irradiance caching in Modo. So I've got, overall it looks okay, and this is great for a preview. You're setting up textures, you're setting up your overall lighting, you're adjusting the replicators or whatever. This is going to work fine. Even quick kind of walkthroughs, you would probably want to make sure you turn on walkthrough mode for your irradiance caching so that you don't get flickery noise. But, you know, overall it works fairly well. Where we get problems and where it's not going to be good for a final quality rendering is anywhere where we have some kind of sudden shifts or some more contrast in our lighting. So if we look, you know, a really good example is down here in the lower right corner where we've got all this undulating noise. Okay, it looks really, really ugly. We don't get the sense of where shadows are really coming from or where they're going. And overall, you know, it just looks kind of muddy, right? And this is going to be the typical kind of thing that you will see with preview rendering. Now, all of the stuff that we're going to look at today with ambient occlusion will also apply to final renders or F9 renders, but I'm going to do this as it applies to irradiance caching inside of the preview render just for now. Okay, so you have a few options with what you can do to improve the quality. So, you know, first and foremost, one of the things that will initially clean up some stuff is turning on environment important sampling. So we can just take an area right here. I'm not going to turn on region renders or anything like that. I'm just going to turn it on and then just mouse over this section. And the environment important sampling will usually do quite a bit to help lessen and clean up noise. So you can see there, the noise is less pronounced. There's less contrast in it. And at the same time, it is overall just a little bit less undulating. You know, there isn't such tight little blobs of splotchy shadows and whatnot. It is still having the problem, and we can see it a little bit more over here on the far right, but it's not as pronounced. Okay, so that's one thing that you can do, and depending on your lighting scenario, especially if you're just lighting with an HDRI or something like that, a lot of times that will clean up your image to enough of a quality where, you know, it might be passable for a final render. Okay, so that's one thing that you can't do, and I'm going to turn that off here right now. Another thing that you can do, and again, this is going to be if you have plenty of time to kill, especially if you're not doing an animation, is to go to your irradiance caching and turn on use IC for second bounce only. And what this is going to do is initially is going to look terrible because it's essentially using Monte Carlo or brute force rendering for the initial lighting. So anything that's directly coming out of your luminous objects or out of your direct lights is going to use just this straight Monte Carlo style. And then for any secondary bounces, I've got two bounces turned on here. So for the second bounce, it's still using my irradiance caching. So if you notice this is going to clean things up quite a bit, but it's going to do that at the cost of a lot of fine grain noise. So if I mouse over here in this same section that was problematic, all of a sudden you see we get really nice clean shadows. Everything looks pretty good. We can actually even make out all of the little bolts on the floor panels. So, you know, this is working pretty well. But this is going to take quite a while to render. And, you know, some tests I did in this render with still some amount of noise, you know, I was looking at half an hour, maybe 35-minute renders, which is not anything terrible, but it's not something that you want to wait for if you're doing an animation, and definitely if you're previewing, you don't want to have to wait that long for a single frame. So other options that you have here, let's turn this back on to first and second bounce, are going to be to actually play with your irradiance cache settings. So there are two different directions you can go with irradiance caching in order to clean up noise. And the first one is going to be getting rid of some of the samples in order to make a smoother render, but that is going to sacrifice accuracy significantly. So if we look back here in the back top right corner, you see that there are some panel lines on this that are completely or nearly completely fading away and we don't even see them. Whereas when we had second bounce only, let's go back there real quick, you actually had a fair amount of detail and contrast in there that we just lose. You can see it there. Even though it's grainy, you can still make it out. All right, so let's go back here. So there are a few things that you can do. So the irradiance rate is going to be the distance between pixels, kind of the minimum distance between pixels that the irradiance cache will use in order to create its cache, you know, that it renders from. So 2.5 pixels means that at the closest they can come together, irradiance cache, renders or pixels are going to be 2.5 pixels apart. So it'll have a pixel and then 2.5 pixels and it can have another one in the cache. And that leads to, you know, this kind of blobby undulation that we see here. So if we take this and increase it, we can actually get a smoother render. But again, we're going to sacrifice quality. So I'm going to take this and let's just double it. And I'm not going to worry about the ratio for a moment. We'll get to that in a second. But if I double this, you'll notice that we actually get somewhat cleaner lighting right down here through these panels where we had some problematic areas. You still see that there is some of that, you know, wavy noise, the wider spread noise, not the fine grain noise, but there's some of that wide noise, but it's farther apart now, so it's actually becoming less pronounced because of that. However, like I mentioned, we are losing detail. So if I go up here and mouse over these panels that were starting to fade already, you know, we're really starting to lose those almost entirely now. So that's going to be problematic. Now, the ratio, just to touch on this before we continue, is how the maximum distance between irradiance cache samples is derived. And so you take the rate and multiply it by the ratio, and that gives you the maximum distance. So at the default, 2.5 and 6, that means that the closest irradiance cache samples can be as 2.5 pixels apart. And with the ratio at 6, you multiply by 2.5, it means the farthest apart they can be is 15 pixels. Now, sometimes that can actually be too low because you might have a big open area that there's very even lighting on, and you want to be able to sample less than every 15 pixels. So you may want to play with that. And right now, my maximum distance that they can be is actually 30 pixels apart. Okay, so and then the last one here is interpolation values, and this is how well it blends between the samples, or how much render effort has gone into blending those. So I'm going to go back to the default here, and I'm just going to increase my interpolation values to 8, which is the maximum, and this is just going to do a better job blending. It will have a little bit of a hit to render time, but a lot of times if I'm going to be adjusting a radiance cache, that's typically the first thing that I'll go with, because it's a pretty decent fire and forget thing to increase your quality. So you can see, even though we're back at 2.5 pixels on the irradiance rate, we're still getting much less undulation here. So something like this could help. Now again, since it's actually blurring between samples, we're going to lose detail here. So that is not going to be an effective way of working if we want to keep details. So now going the other direction, if we want to increase the quality, increase the detail, we would want to decrease the irradiance rate. But at the same time, we might still have wide open areas. So as we decrease the rate, we'll want to increase the ratio, at least proportionally, sometimes more than proportionally, just depends on how your image is. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to set my irradiance rate down to 1. So pixels can be right next to each other with the cache. And I'm going to set my ratio. Right now, I'm just going to keep it proportional and set it up to 15. So now with that, if we mouse over some of these areas, so now I've adjusted the rate, the ratio, and the interpolation values. And everything else is pretty much left at stock. And you can see that we're starting to get a fairly good and clean looking render. Again, since we're using irradiance caching, we'll tend to lose some of these, especially back in the distance, kind of details. They're just kind of flattening out, and we're not seeing them nearly as well as we did, with the second bounce only irradiance cache. All right, but this is going to be a good kind of place to go. So I'm going to hop over here. Actually, just a second. Let me pause that. No need to keep that running. But let's hop over to Photoshop. You can see some examples I actually have already rendered out. So this is going to be that brute force method. So second bounce only on the irradiance cache. You see we get really nice defined details, even all the way in the background. You can see that same panel here closer. And so we're seeing most of those details, even though it's farther away. That's looking good. There is a bit of noise. And this was about a 35-minute render. All right, so there's definitely a trade-off here, and we still have noise, so something to consider. All right, so now, and these are some of these are a little bit lower resolution, but here is our basic irradiance cache values. Here is if we increase the rate so that we are getting the samples farther apart. You can see that we get some areas, we get less of the undulation, but we still have big splotches in other areas. So that can be, you know, again, problematic. Now here it is, if we have increased it, this is essentially where I have the settings right now, where we had finished, where we've got the rate at 1, the ratio at 15, and the interpolation at 8. So that gives you a fairly decent quality. And then I've got one more here where the only change I had made was I increased the amount of samples. So let's hop back over here. The amount of irradiance rays from 256 to 512. And the difference that you get between here and here now is actually fairly significant. Now, this was about a 5-minute render, and this one was closer to 9. So it is significantly more time, but it's still much less than, you know, the 35 that we were looking for here. So now we're going to actually look at taking and implementing the ambient occlusion, which I've got right here. And you can see you're getting a lot of those details in there. All right, we're going to implement this ambient occlusion in order to get a better quality final render. All right, so a little bit of setup over here in Modo. Now you can take and you have your render here, and you can see that I've got my ambient occlusion in here. And I've also added a depth output and a luminous shading output. And we're actually going to use both of those and see how they can be implemented here. Now, if you're using preview to render, you can pretty much just leave ambient occlusion as is and render it out, and that's going to be fine. You may want to, if you're rendering in here, go up to your options and render all outputs so that you get everything at the same time. That can be helpful and a time saver. However, if you're going to be changing up some things, but you're going to keep the same, say, ambient occlusion because you're not going to change any camera angle or anything like that, and you're not going to change any, you know, basic illumination, you could leave out the depth and the luminous and the ambient occlusion and just render those separately. And if you wanted to, you know, maybe change color on some of the panels, you could just re-render your final color output. But if you're rendering through here, you don't need to worry about any settings. If you're rendering through F9 render, you want to increase your ambient occlusion rays. The default is 64. You want to go at least up to 256. 512 will give you a really nice result. So just something to keep in mind that you want to increase that if you're going to be using the F9 render. All right, so now that we've got that, let's hop back over to Photoshop. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start by going over here and grabbing my ambient occlusion and copying it. And then I'm just going to paste it right on top of my final render. Okay, now, kind of the traditional tried and true way to work with ambient occlusion is to just set it on top, set the blend mode to multiply, and then, of course, that looks terrible, so then we just adjust the opacity. Okay, so the problem with that is that it's going to tend to just make your scene a lot darker. Now, you can go in and adjust exposure and things like that to compensate for it, but you're going to tend to wash things out. And the more you decrease the opacity, you know, you're decreasing the overall darkening of your scene, but then at the same time, you're also washing away the effect of the ambient occlusion. So if you get much below about 50%, you're really kind of defeating the purpose. So that's really not going to quite work for us. So let's go back here and I'm going to set this back to normal. And what we're going to do is we're going to use the ambient occlusion. And this is true of just about anything that you're going to deal with value-based images. So anything that's essentially a grayscale image that you get out of Modo or any 3D package for that matter, we're looking at the values that it gives us. We're not looking at the image itself. We're just looking at the light and dark values. And we're going to use those in this case to create a mask to go in and actually edit our image. So what I'm going to do here first of all is let's go ahead and duplicate that so we've got an extra copy of it. And now what I want to do is I want to pull the levels on this a bit so that I get kind of white all the way down to black. So let's go ahead and bring up my levels, oops, which came up off screen. And you can see that here on the lighter end, you know, we only get up to about a 65% white. And that's why when we put this on multiply, it just kind of makes the whole image really dark. So the very first thing we can do is just pull down our white point till we just get, you know, nice values here, okay? And we can do the same thing with the black, depending on what you're doing, but what we're gonna end up using this for is a mask, and we're gonna invert it. So black areas, or areas that are completely black, are essentially going to be unmasked areas. So they're gonna be areas that are getting the full effect of what we're working on. Areas that are white are going to get none of the effect. So you don't wanna over-crush your black. So you can see, like, back in here, I have some details. Over here, I have some details. If I pull too much on the black, we're gonna lose those details. And again, we're kind of defeating the purpose of the ambient occlusion at that point. So I'm just gonna look for kind of a nice, happy mid-ground here. You may wanna adjust the mid-tones a little bit. But again, you just want to be looking for nice amounts of contrast, and that's pretty much it. Now, the nice thing about what we're going to do with this is using it as a mask means that we won't have these black values just completely crushing what's underneath. So that's going to be really helpful. So I'm going to leave that right about there, and I think that works pretty well. And then I'm just going to go ahead and hit Control I to invert that. And this is going to be now what we'll use as a mask for a color correction. So let's go ahead, and I'm just going to select all that and copy it. And then I'm going to go down here, and I'm going to start just with exposure. Nice, easy place to start. So I'm just going to add an adjustment layer of exposure. Okay. And then I'm going to go into the channels, and I'm going to reveal my mask. You have to actually make it visible to be able to paste into it. And then I'm just going to paste, which right now has my inverted and color corrected ambient occlusion in. So now this is a mask for this. And now the cool thing is, if I adjust exposure, you see it's adjusting exposure in those occluded areas. All right. And it doesn't over crush them or anything like that. It's just, you know, it's just adjusting them. And I have a lot of granularity here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull exposure down a little bit, and my gamma as well. So I'm adjusting both the gamma and the exposure here. So maybe something like that. All right, now we can check and see. So yeah, we're definitely getting more detail. You notice that our character here, who is kind of standing out and a little bit more in the open, he's popping out more as we do that. So that's working pretty well. Okay, and I like that. And you know what? I'm going to do one more thing here. So let's go ahead, and you could do curves or levels, anything. I'm going to do levels. All right, so because levels gives you a pretty straightforward way to add some color variation. So what I'm going to do again is I'm going to go into channels, reveal my mask, paste, and then hide that again. And now we're going to go back up here to my levels. And what I'm going to do here is I'm not going to adjust any of my brightness values with the levels, but I'm going to use this to add some color correction to my occluded areas or my shaded areas. So if I go down to, let's check my red here first. And you see, as I pull this red midpoint, I'm either making my my occluded areas hotter or cooler. And I want to give this whole thing a little bit more of a kind of a cool tone to it. So let's pull that way a little bit. Green, I'm also going to adjust just a little bit over, because I don't want it to look too greeny. And then let's go just a little bit this way with the blue. And there we go, we've got a little bit cooler color. So, you know, I could also, once I've got the red and the green set here in levels, I can actually go cooler to warmer fairly easily just by, you know, going on either side of 1.0 for my mid value here. So, you know, anything above a value of 1 is going to give us cooler. Anything below a value of 1 is going to give us warmer. So let's go just a little bit here. I don't want to overdo this, but I do want it to be visible. So I might overdo it a tiny bit, you know, maybe something like that. Okay. That might be a little heavy handed, but you know, when things compress on YouTube, I want it to be visible. All right. So now we've got, you know, there's our original. There's adjusting exposure. There is adjusting the levels. And what you often have happen when you're doing something like ambient occlusion is it doesn't take into account any luminous values. So that's why having the luminous render in here really helps. So here, let me actually go ahead and open up the luminous render, which looks like I left out. There it is. So I'm just gonna again copy that and just paste it onto here. And this you can just go ahead and set to screen if you want. And then you can adjust the values, you know, let's maybe pull it down a little. Maybe you can add a little blur here and then it adds a little bit of bloom. So, you know, let's just put on a little Gaussian blur. Maybe just a couple pixels. That way you get a little bit of kind of bloom coming off those lights. you know, so that way we're not losing, you see in the background there, we're not losing the illumination coming off those lights. That's probably a little heavy-handed, so I'll back it off even a little bit more. Okay, so now the cool thing is since we're now just dealing with values instead of trying to just use the renders, you know, as is, as they come out of Modo and just, you know, setting a blend mode on them, this allows us a lot more fluidity with what we're doing. So now what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to use a depth pass here in order to create another secondary mask on those corrections that I made. So in this case, I don't really want the ambient occlusion stuff to hit in the foreground that much. So we're going to use this to mask off those two masked already color correction layers and get more control over where that's being applied. So let's go ahead and copy all this. We'll go back to this one here. Oops. And now what I'll do is I'm just going to select both of these. And let's add in a folder, which I'll just call AOCC. And now what I'm going to do is just add a mask to that folder. So if I go ahead and take and paste in my depth, now I can make it invisible. Now I can sit and do things like adjust levels here, and we'll actually see more or less of the color correction taking place. So let's start just by clamping this in a bit. And you can see right now, the way that it's set up, we're getting white values, which is going to be visibility here in the front, and we're losing it in the back, which is actually the inverse of what I want. So I'm going to take this whole thing and select it and invert it. And now you can see we're getting the warmer colors here in front, and it's trailing off and giving us more of the ambient occlusion in the back. All right, so I could also do things like adjust levels on here. You know, maybe I don't want to get no effect here in front, so I can take my blacks, which is the stuff that's masked here in the front, and I can just pull up my black outputs. And as I pull this up here, I'll pull it up pretty far, you can see that now we're getting that influence back in here. So I can adjust this now to make more fine-tuned controlled corrections over what areas of my scene are now receiving some of the ambient occlusion. All right, so that's the basic idea, and that's going to be a key to a lot of image sweetening, image post-production that you'll do with rendered images. Is, you know, you want to be able to take stuff that you're getting out of Modo and turning into something useful that gives you more control and more power and flexibility when you're working in post. All right, so, you know, just as kind of one more example here, I'm just going to take all of this. And let's go to a new doc and just paste this in. And so, you know, once you have some decent stuff in here, I'm just going to go ahead and throw in, I've got my, this is actually my splash screen post-production action. So I'm just going to play this. And it's going to have a few things. It's going to ask me a few things, but I don't really need to make any corrections. And there we go. So that's added some, it's added some kind of two-level vignetting. It's added a little bit of bloom. It's added some chromatic aberration around the edges. So this adds kind of a lot of stuff to a little bit of noise, which is cool if you have a little bit of noise in your renders. You know, we were trying to reduce it a bit, and now we're adding a little bit of noise just over the top of everything. So, you know, that's kind of a finished look here. So what we're going for here, and let's just go ahead and take, I want to go back to my original image, which is just take and paste up on top here. So what we're doing in the course of, you know, just a couple of minutes is we're going from this as our base render, which, you know, there's nothing horrible about that. But then we're going to this just by using our ambient occlusion pass in order to get more control over the visibility of some of our details, especially stuff in the background that tends to get washed out by our irradiance caching. We're getting that back. And then with just the implementation of a little macro, we're going in and getting a nice finished image. So you can go from just a really basic image and just rendering out your image and an occlusion pass. In this case, I also used the luminous and the depth, but you don't really need those all the time. And we're implementing everything to get a much more finished image. So we're going from this to this over the course of just a few minutes. The idea here is just to pull a little more detail, add a little bit more emphasis and focus, and get something that looks a little bit more polished. Let me know in the comments if you would like to see kind of an advanced version of ambient occlusion, which is actually, there's a little bit of a setup, and you're not using an ambient occlusion pass, but a render pass, and that will allow you to get some of the problems with ambient occlusion taken care of, such as areas of transparency and luminous shading. We can actually incorporate those into a more advanced advanced ambient occlusion pass. And let me know in the comments also if you'd like to see a video about doing some simple post-production macros that can help you get a few look dev things that you can have in a can just to pop out really quickly, kind of like, you know, like this one that I do with my splash screens for the videos. So that does it for this one. If you like this video or videos like it, please follow me on Patreon. That's patreon.com/Ellery. And if you would like to get this episode or any other episode of Moto with Ellery a la carte or in packs, you can check those out on Gumroad. That's gumroad.com/Ellery. Like, share, and subscribe. Your support really helps, and I appreciate it. Now, go make something cool, and I'll see you in the next episode.